in student affairs, and I know that the chancellor is very interested in working with the work group and some of the students who are part of the work group, and is very willing to meet with kind of a representative group of people here as part of the work group process. He is not available today to meet, and I didn't realize you guys were coming up here.
I'd like to know if there's in his office or not.
I don't know.
Can you 100%?
He's in a meeting.
He's in a meeting. Could we interrupt it? This is incredibly important. We have over 8,000 signatures.
Yes.
795 comments. He did not come to either of the listening meetings, which your administration called. He's the one who sent that email. How buried such an important service to close down. It's really important.
And
we have more than 200 people.
So
we want to see him now.
If he's not
I want to tell
there
him.
Is, there is very much a, you know, there is very much an optics thing if apparently this is not his highest priority then.
If he's here,
actually
he won't come out and talk to us, something's wrong.
I think, are we looking for a meeting now, or we're looking to give him the signatures and
we
set up a meeting?
We want to deliver the petition.
We're
I'd like to
about,
read it.
We're
looking
for about 2 minutes.
We're asking for a meeting right now. We'll talk with him when we're ready and prepared, and he's ready and prepared. Right?
Does he care about the safety of the students?
He does,
no,
actually. Well, it's been a lot of months. You know, it's been a lot of months.
A couple months.
You know, this was a June decision, and we're
so I would say, he's. I talked to him this morning. He's committed to meeting with representatives of this group as early as this week.
He's been
great.
Committed before and he didn't come.
Really?
He told the president of the graduate student organization if at all possible he would be there.
Is the DO reporter here?
Email.
Did she make it up the stairs? Did you catch that? Has promised to meet with but did not show
absolutely.
Up and now is promising
yeah.
to meet with again.
He could,
yeah,
make
here now.
He could make a big step forward. He could just come and accept the petition and then say he's going to. Would you be willing to go in and ask him that?
Because this looks like
we could take less than on fire.
There are a lot of survivors of rape that are in this group, and they're feeling very strongly about it. I'm a survivor of rape. I know how important this is. So faculty, students, staff, everybody really. He could make a huge difference if he could walk out the door and just say,
yeah.
accept
so like the trust
yeah.
has been broken, and this would be one way to help establish.
So could we move up the seventh floor, 700? And then I'll see if he's able to come up there for a few minutes.
Is he on the seventh? Why can't we just
no,
come
so
here?
It's a room.
Here. Why are we
yeah. No, I mean, we're here, we're united, we don't want to divide as a group. I mean, I think there's enough space.
There's
for
enough
the
space up there.
Oh, yeah.
That's
no,
we have enough space here.
We have enough space here.
We didn't bring everybody, so there'd be room for him.
You guys, there's a conference room. There's a conference room upstairs.
We're here.
But we're not asking for
place. I'm not even entirely sure the conference room would fit everyone here, to be entirely honest, with the size of the table that's in there.
Give me a couple minutes.
Thank you. I am the Assistant Chancellor and Chief of Staff. Thank you for coming. I know that this is a group that is very passionate about the issues that are concerning our community. So the Chancellor will meet with you to receive your petition, but I was wondering if it would be possible for us to move up into the conference room in 700, up one floor. It's gonna be a tight squeeze, but if we could do that, I think that would be a better place and environment for us to meet with the Chancellor so that he could hear you and receive your petition. Does that sound all right?
It makes more sense to mobilize one person than to mobilize 50 people to us.
Yeah.
It's plenty of room for one more person
offices,
out here.
There are a number of university offices up here. So.
Well, that's why we came, just so that we could be heard.
He should see all of us.
You all should come.
Everyone can
come
upstairs.
Up.
We came here to see the Chancellor. We came to the office of the Chancellor, who doesn't have the time to see us, who missed out on listening meetings about one of the most important rules of safety on this campus. I think as our Chancellor, he should be here to hear one of the many multiple times all of these people have tried to reach out to him.
It's one floor.
We will not be disrespectful.
It's
we're missing something that's important in class
there.
To be
like
here.
We've got the chairs. We've gone to meetings. Just want the Chancellor to come out. It's a lot to mobilize all of us and keep us concentrated and united in our efforts. He's just one person. There's a lot of space. I could fit 10 people right there. We really just want to hand in this petition to him and have him agree to some of the concerns that we have and that he's meaning to address them.
And it sounds like we want to be met on our terms rather than on his terms. That's what they do.
Isn't he representing us?
I think it's just out of respect of everybody here to just be in a space where people can spread out and talk. But
so
I want to be here.
Out of perspective,
yeah,
you couldn't
be here.
We are all in. I hear what you're saying. So just
the chancellor has a little yellow thing. This is good for students because it's good for students because their voices need to be heard.
Absolutely, absolutely. So if you would just give us 2 minutes, I will check with him and see if he can come out and meet with you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
I was going to say, Becca's going to mostly run the show. We do have a petition, the 8,000, what was the number again?
137.
8,137 signatures on the petition related to the Advocacy Center.
Thank you so much.
741 comments that were made on that petition.
Great.
And I know Becca was going to read some particularly comments to you, as well as
yeah,
other folks.
Yeah, you'll see at the top of that, it sort of explains that although the original petition, which came right after the Advocacy Center closure was announced, which garnered 4,000 signatures in 4 days and is up to over 8,000 signatures now. We've sort of updated it to show that we really appreciate you guys have been working with us. I feel like we've been pushing you to really think about survivors and to also not in the future do closed door decisions without our consulting with us at all. So, but we think that you should really read that preface, and we really, really feel that survivors' voices have not been heard and student voices, so we'd like to read a few of them. And a lot of people here, which there were at least 200 people at our rally today, mostly outside, but we're here to represent survivor voices and also talk about the need for true institutional-wide comprehensive policies, which I think you want to work on, but we want to make it be one of the most top priorities. It's an issue that affects stand here and listen to some of the comments that people here want to present to me.
I'm standing here.
Okay, great. So I will I also hope that you'll take the time to read through them. There's a lot of alumni.
So,
okay,
yeah.
Great. Yeah, I mean, I was really moved by them, and it gives you a better sense of how, unfortunately, how victims, this is someone from Syracuse, New York. Victims of sexual and violence and rape need help in a safe, private place that exists primarily for their support and comfort. They do not need to walk by fraternity houses in which many of these sexual assaults take place in order to receive this help.
Chancellor, I think you should know that this is a student-led movement, but it is greatly supported by faculty, staff, and administrators as well. So this is a very diverse group of people who are here, also urging you to listen to what this community has to say, not only to listen to what we have to say, but also to incorporate these comments and feelings into university policy. One of the comments that I have says, rape happens, and closing the Advocacy Center only hurts victims.
I'd like to read this and also add something to it. We trusted you, the administration, to make our university a better place for all of us. But I gotta say, you've really disappointed us by shutting down the Advocacy Center without student consent. It's just very hard to trust the administration anymore. We hope you bring it back. We could put them all in one building and call it the Awareness Center. Please do something. But I'd also like to just make a small note that you're a DPS officer, right?
Cool.
Yes, I am.
It was nice that you guys, you know, put our safety, you know, somewhere on that list of things you care about on this campus. I mean, after meetings or listening or something, I'm sure it's on there. But the fact that a DPS officer had to come for a very, very peaceful rally of really respectful students who've just been trying so hard to reach out to you about any issue instead of partying or whatever people in the administration do think we do.
No,
this is what we
me.
do.
No,
but, that, all right, well, that's awesome that you'd like to come. Thank you.
Have him read a statement.
Cool.
Yeah.
Nice. Like
anybody else want to read a comment?
So, sure. Right, this comment reads, the Advocacy Center was a safe space where victims could feel comfortable. Now it's gone, and what are you going to do to change it? And I would like to add to this comment, what are you going to do to make sure that student voices and the working group's voices are heard in any changes that are implemented? And how can you prioritize this above, for instance, the school's party ranking, which is something that is so trivial when compared to students' welfare on campus.
This comment said, Chancellor, for one of your first actions to be made as a new chancellor, to be the removal of the Advocacy Center is an embarrassment to the university and a great disappointment to the students and community members of Syracuse. Rape and sexual assault is not strictly a health issue. That was a student from ESF.
I have a comment here. SU needs to be more concerned with the health, safety, and well-being of its students than with its reputation as a party school. Listen to your students. Reopen the Advocacy Center.
So let me just say quickly, this is what Syracuse students do wonderfully, and I really appreciate the activism, contrary to any impression you might have. I know that Rebecca Reed Kantwitz has been working very hard and is determined, working with the task force, to both listen and respond to the aspects of advocacy and the Advocacy Center that are so valued and that I've heard extensively from all of you are very valued. I've also heard that very much people wanting to be consulted about major decisions at the university before they're announced. As chancellor, I really am committed to that, and so I've learned from this experience. I would say at the same time that occasionally the university faces challenges that have to be responded to as the world changes. And
it sounds like you were behind doors for 2 years talking about this. Didn't consult the Advocacy Center, didn't speak with any students, no polls were done, no surveys, no faculty, the university senate wasn't consulted. I mean, I don't see how that's a quick response. That was 2 years behind doors.
So I'm not gonna argue on this at this point, other than to say I'm very eager to work with the task force, and I've been encouraging our Vice Chancellor for Student Affairs to do that and to figure out the important needs of survivors that the Advocacy Center was meeting and that I've heard very clearly about, and to make sure that's incorporated in what we do going forward. And I think you agree with that,
yes,
is that correct?
Absolutely.
So, and that's what I've requested. So I really appreciate you're all doing this. This is what Syracuse should be proud of. And I hear you on that as well. Okay,
are you going to be at the next listening meeting?
Yeah, so I hope to, yes.
The next listening meeting will be determined by the work group so that they can format something that will bring out the most information, the most helpful information. And so if the work group would like the chance to be there, then we'll go on. But we're really giving that over to the students, faculty, and staff who are part of trying to find the solution.
Can you
make a commitment to never close down a center like this, vital to students, again, in this way, without consent, without figuring out a replacement plan?
So that's such a broad question that I have to think about it. What I can say is that, seriously, because the range of circumstances you get in this job are pretty extraordinary, as I suspect many of you will someday appreciate, because you'll be leaders. What I will say is I am committed to listening and learning from the experience I had with this.
I mean, it's really important. I just don't know how you could shut that down. Can you promise to read all those comments personally?
I've already said I'm going to
There are a couple
this.
Of other
okay.
comments
so
that
fine.
I think
so,
you would like
thank,
to share.
Thanks. I'm going to have to stop now, but thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
So,
now, I think the work group has got to be better incorporated into our governance processes. The reason this is happening, has been said repeatedly, is a lack of consultation, a lack of a discussion with the stakeholders who are most affected by any change to these support services. So the work group is not going to solve the problem. It's good the chancellor came out to meet with us, but we had to storm his door to get him to meet with us, okay? So we've written letters, we've had petitions, and I'm a faculty member with tenure, and I'm standing here. These folks are brave to come in here and do this, and that needs to be commended. But we need to see that the institution is responding through the governance processes that are already in place so that we have structures in place that get people to put into input into decisions about how the university changes things. When we closed the nursing school, that went through the university senate. There was a long process. We all consulted. It was an anguishing decision. And now you're having to reverse engineer everything. And that's not fair to you. You're caught in that. So there has to be a way forward that's beyond the working group structure. Because that will get us back in this office again. If that's all we get, that's going to get us back here. Right. And it's going to get more of us back here.
I would say the work group is tasked to set forward a set of recommendations. So not, I guess, to solve everything, but to at least put in place various recommendations. So, and those who do not know, Dawn Johnson and Chase Catalano are the chairs of the work group. I have met with them, and they're in the process at this point of setting up that series of meetings and collecting data. There is data, there is information, and so the work group will see that.
We would like to see it too.
Yes. Well, yeah. That will be up to the work group on what they want to share. Okay. So I would just say, you know, sometimes in terms of the decision, sometimes when there's personnel and compliance issues, sometimes it is not a democratic process. I would just say that. I know students, everybody wants all information, but sometimes you're just not able to do that.
Are you implying, or can you explain what personnel that you need?
Are employees involved?
Are you implying that you shut down the Advocacy Center over personnel issues rather than hiring new personnel? I just want to know because we haven't really gotten a comprehensive reason.
Yeah, I know you are. I will say this. It has been tasked for the work group to be able to find information, call information, and put out what they believe is appropriate. So,
but not if it's personnel issues
for any personnel.
Well, you mean individual personnel. You don't mean categories of personnel.
No.
So categories can be discussed, but you can't talk about individual people.
And it's the same with statistics and numbers. You don't give out specific names or situations.
I don't think anyone would expect that.
No. So. I would particularly like to thank the undergrads that are here today. Most of us weren't here over the summer, and so this movement was started and has been led by grad students, which I thank you for greatly. But I think it really speaks to the undergraduate body that you were still able to come out today and to respond to this call to action, and thank you for being here. Woo!
I'd also like to encourage everyone to come to the open forum at 4:30 in Hendricks Chapel this Monday, where the Chancellor will be talking about Fast Forward Syracuse and taking questions from the audience, which may be another great opportunity to talk to him.
I have a question. Is for the working group, is the possibility of having something like an advocacy center outside of the health center off the table or on the table? In other words, is it still a possibility that after they discuss things, it could be that there's an advocacy center separate from the health center? Yeah. Or is that, have they been instructed that that's not a possibility?
We're not able nor interested to go right back to what we had. And the work group will understand why, as people get more information. But is there a need for a center that provides community and support for survivors? Mm-hmm. That will be up to the work group to decide. That's not off the table.
Right. Because I think one important issue for people to think about is that a lot of rape survivors, and I include myself in that, would not go to a health center to report it. They would not, even if the advocacy center is located there. That's why it's separate. And so that isn't going to satisfy a lot of the survivors if that's off the table.
Well, and that's what I think, that's what the work group is charged to do, is to really figure out what are the needs and what are the gaps. But I don't want to make promises off the fly with this, but I will say this. The Chancellor would not have put together a work group if he didn't really care about what he was hearing and learning about people. So that's why he felt it was really important to get people passionate and committed to this, to think about these issues and dig deep.
I just want to jump in kind of quickly, but he didn't get us passionate about it. It was the closure of the Advocacy Center without any consent that got us passionate about it. And it's actually been his inability to meet with us in listening sessions and anything till we literally stormed his office and then were instructed to leave and come back and meet and talk and do something other. You know, again, that got us passionate and will keep us passionate until real change happens on this campus. And I love this school. I absolutely love the school, but I am absolutely disappointed in the Chancellor and the administration today, and that's so disappointing to me as an undergrad who came here for a school that I absolutely love every day.
Passion and commitment you're talking about, I hope it'll extend to everyone in here and everyone outside and all the student body that doesn't even really know what's going on will educate and mobilize. So I want to leave this with you. It says no more decisions about us without us, but us is the people here, the people outside, and the whole campus, not just the work group.
One thing I'll say is that with the preface to the petition, we also asked specifically for an administration apology. So we'd like that to come from the chancellor and all the people who are involved. I feel like that's important for bridging trust. It's not just sort of stepping over and saying, okay, cool, we listened to you, now we're going to do a work group. At least, I don't know that everyone feels that as a priority, but I do, and I think a lot of other people working on this do, is that in order to move forward, sometimes you have to really reconcile and say, we're really sorry. We hear you, we won't do this again, which I think people are making steps to, but you're jumping over a step without that formal apology. Yes. There was an email from the chancellor that apologized for something they did with parking spaces that came out recently, whereas there was no apology for the Advocacy Center. Mm-hmm.
For sure. Yeah.
This is just a reminder that we must remain vigilant. With this new change in leadership at the highest level of this university, the challenge is to prevent benevolent neoliberalism from becoming an oppressive force that continues in this university behind closed doors. I want to go on record and say that I feel that you, Rebecca, have done a great job with the resources that you've had, but I think it's important to note that this benevolent neoliberalism is oppressive. These changes are oppressive. They're happening under the guise of justice, and this is not justice. This is not happening. So we must be vigilant that this doesn't continue throughout our campus and throughout our university, because a lot of people are very concerned that this is just a drop in the bucket. This is just the first step.
Well, thank you, everyone. This has been great. As the president of the Graduate Student Organization, I can't believe we have so much student energy. This is amazing and fantastic. So I thank you, everyone, for coming out, for coming up here. Just thank you. I cannot believe we have this much energy and passion. Thank you. And yeah, we will continue to push on everyone to make sure that the things actually change, the real action happens. Definitely come out to the open forum, 4:30 at Hendricks Chapel on Monday. The chancellor will be there giving statements and asking questions. Thank you, everyone.